Hi, I'm Carol Anne Riddell, and welcome to Book It with CA. So I am just gonna own this. I am obsessed with our dog Hudson, and not just Hudson, pretty much all animals. And I know I'm not alone. For a lot of us, our pets are family. Today, we are talking with Sophie Gamand. She's an award-winning photographer whose work is focused on dogs, including two books, Wet Dog and Pit Bull Flower Power. As Sophie explains it, her camera lens is a powerful tool to advocate for animals and better understand humans. Take a listen.
Sophie, thank you so much for joining me today.
Hi, thank you for having me. I'm super excited.
Me too. I'm a huge fan of your work. I've got Pit Bull Flower Power right behind me. But before we talk about your books, I wanted to ask, what drew you to photography to begin with?
So I think photography, you know, as came into my life really when I was a young kid. And I think I was very introvert, shy, and communicating with other people was so difficult. Photography became my way in. It was a place where I could create intimacy at a distance. And there was a camera and the lens between the people and myself. And that really helped me communicate and bond with people.
That's so interesting, intimacy at a distance. And you actually studied law and opera singing before photography, right?
Yeah, I have a master's degree in art law and international law. And then I studied opera singing for about 10 years when I lived in Europe. And then I moved to New York.
Okay, so then comes photography. How did dogs become your focus?
So about, you know, a little over 10 years ago, I moved to New York from Europe and my English was good, but not perfect. And I had to, you know, learn everything, like just standing at the grocery store and deciding what product I should buy. Like everything was new and challenging. So again, I found myself being intimidated by people. And I had my camera. That was the only thing I had, and a husband, the camera. And I basically started taking photos. Similarly, you know, as when I was a kid and a teenager, I think I was trying to create intimacy at a distance again. And soon I realized my lens was always pointing towards dogs, and it kind of snowballed from there.
And it's not just about photographing dogs, because you have become over the years a huge animal advocate. Can you tell us a little bit about how photographs are part of that and your work in shelters?
Yeah, absolutely. I think as an artist, you know, I always wanted my work to be meaningful in some ways. So not just pretty work, but also work that has a message or, you know, helps a cause or changes perception on things. And so when I started taking photos of dogs, and I very soon heard about animal rescue here in the US and in New York in particular, and the crazy amount of animals that are sitting in shelters, I knew that I wanted my photography to help. And so I started taking photos of dogs who were up for adoptions, basically just creating that beautiful portrait that would help connect with potential adopters. Mm-hmm. And it became kind of a full-time volunteer career, basically. And I became an advocate and a shelter photographer full-time.
Yeah, and you typically go into these shelters and do this for free, is that right?
Yeah, absolutely, yes. So I'm basically, I consider myself as an artist first and an animal advocate second. So I'm able to make a living with my art, selling prints and books and products with my work on them. And that allows me to photograph shelter dogs for free.
Why dogs and not other animals? Is it simply because you love dogs? You were drawn to them?
I mean, I have a connection with all animals. I think my most loved animal growing up was a bunny. So I've always had animals around me. I wanted to be a vet as a kid. And I think dogs just are just different. You know, I think they're almost not animals. They're really the link between the animal world and the human world. And that's what's fascinating me about them and that relationship we have with them and them with us. So naturally, also I feel like taking photos of dogs comes so naturally for me. It's easy. When I go to the shelter, I can photograph 40, 50 dogs in one day, just dun, 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 dun. If I try cats, you know, it's like 5 cats in one day because it's a very different process. So I just feel like it comes natural to me with dogs.
Yeah, but that certainly, I think, comes across in your photographs. So I want to talk a bit about your books. Let's start with Wet Dog, which was when your photography really sort of took off. Is that right?
Absolutely. Yeah. Wet Dog launched my career basically and just gave me that financial security and just the wings I needed, you know, to keep diving deeper into dog photography.
The pictures are amazing and hilarious and adorable. But where did that idea come from?
It actually really happened, you know, by total accident. I was taking photos at a groomer in the Bronx. And basically I wanted to photograph the haircut. You know, the dogs would come in puffy and like disheveled, and then they would leave, you know, perfect and square and like little robot dogs. I love that transformation from the wild animal to the perfect pet. And right. That's what I was there to photograph. But I also wanted to be completely free and in the moment of creating something with that groomer. And when he started bathing the dogs, I realized, oh, wow, like there's something that's happening here that I need to photograph. And when I saw the wet dog photos, and my family was like, these are really good. You should share them online and see what happens. So I did, and it took off like crazy. I went viral with the project, which got me the book deal and then awards, and it just kickstarted me and propelled me into a career of dog photography, which was
right
kind of weird.
Was there a particular story in the wet dog series or one of the dogs that you can tell us about that, you know, was particularly funny or interesting for you?
I think for me the photo that really sealed the deal was the portrait of Oscar, and it's a very stoical portrait, and there's a little bit of sadness in his eye. When I saw that portrait, that's when I knew that series had potential and that it was meaningful to me, because it was not just about funny faces and ha ha ha, look at the miserable wet dog. Of course, that's your first initial reaction when you see the portrait. But that particular portrait taught me that there was something deeper in what happens when you bathe a dog. They are at their most vulnerable. They have to trust you. It's something they don't like. There's something that really, that moment reveals a lot about our relationship with dogs and how much they rely on us and how much they have to trust us.
The vulnerability there is really moving.
Yeah, I think so, yes.
So let's talk about pit bull flower power. It's so interesting on so many levels, especially visually, because the dogs are wearing flower crowns. And I think that that is, for some people, very contrary to the perception that they might have of pit bulls. So how did that come about?
Yeah, it's basically exactly that. I wanted to photograph pit bulls in a way that I felt had not been done before. And so I was basically just thinking about ideas. And I thought, how do we know pit bull? We know them with teeth and, you know, collars with spikes and leather and big motorbikes. You know, like it's a very masculine, macho image that we have of them. Toxic masculinity, I would say.
Yeah.
And so I wanted to take the complete opposite. And I figured that I just wonder if art can transform the way we perceive these dogs. And in doing so, can we save lives? Can we stop the massacre? Because when you work in rescue, you realize very quickly that hundreds of thousands of pit bulls are euthanized in America alone, you know, every year. And because these dogs are so misunderstood and feared, I felt like it was an issue that was swept under the rug a lot. And these dogs did not have any visibility. They would just be euthanized in the back of the shelter, you know, day in and day out, all year round. And I wanted to give them a presence, and a presence that was not threatening, but a presence that, you know, mattered and make them look soulful and beautiful and approachable.
If I understand it correctly, you say yourself that originally you had some fear of pit bulls, you know, as a breed. So you had to kind of overcome that as well, right?
Absolutely. I was born and raised in France, if my accent did not give that away already. And over there, we have the same prejudice against pit bulls. You know, they're considered to be dangerous, unpredictable, and only thugs would want a dog like this. And so I grew up with the exact same prejudice. But there was such a disconnect between that and the dogs I would meet at the shelter and the pit bull owners I would meet that were normal people. And their dogs were normal. If anything, I felt like pit bulls had something that was so gentle, and they're very attached to humans. So it kind of like I had those two images and it didn't match up. So I was afraid of them. And at the shelter, each time I would take photos of them, I'd be like, okay, click, click, next dog, quick. I wouldn't want to touch them. I didn't want to interact with them. And it made me feel icky about myself and the prejudice. I felt like that was unfair for these dogs that had done nothing to me. And I knew that creating an art project with them would force me to touch them and meet a lot of these dogs and understand them. And finally, you know, make up my own mind, not let the media dictate how I should feel about them. So fear was really the motivator. You know, I just wanted to confront that fear and work through it. And so the project, you know, I started in the summer 2014. So it's been, you know, over 6 years by now. And I photographed a little bit about 450 dogs in animal shelters around the country. So all the models from the series are shelter pit bulls. So you would think these are the most dangerous, if you will, because they come from neglect and abuse. Several of my dog models were from actual dog fighting rings that were busted by the police. And so I really met the full spectrum of pit bulls. We have to open our mind to the fact that the breed doesn't really matter. It's about that individual dog. And that's what that project really taught me.
Sophie, how did you get the dogs to keep the flower crowns on their heads?
Well, I mean, you have to remember that my models mostly are dogs who sit in a cage all day, every day, and they get very little interaction with the outside world. So for them, the photo shoot is kind of a fun experience and a treat, and it's challenging in positive ways. You know, I always have a handler there, and we use the opportunity to teach the dog how to sit or to just reinforce some of the things they've learned in the shelter. They get a lot of treats and attention. So most of these dogs really love it. Sometimes they're a little more shy. So I think putting the flower crown for them, it's kind of part of this like fun experience of like, woo, yeah, what are we doing today? You know, and I get cookies and it's so fun. Yay. So it's, you know, sometimes it's not that hard.
I want to talk about a few of their stories. I loved reading about Murdoch so much so that I read it aloud to my husband and my dog this morning. Wow. So he was the first pit bull you photographed who was actually a survivor of dog fighting. Is that right?
His owner. So he was seized in a case against his owner. So his owner was being pursued for a dog fighting activity. And so it was not like a big operation. They think he was just fighting his dog, maybe. I mean, yeah. Murdoch, if you see the photo, you know, half his face is really damaged. He lost an eye on his way to the shelter. So he was seized in the cruelty case, which means he became evidence. These dogs, I find very interesting too, and I would love to do a project about these dogs specifically. When they're seized as evidence in a legal case, they cannot be adopted. They cannot interact with the public. And so Murdoch had to stay like that for a year at the shelter. It's kind of a invisible dogs that stay hidden in the shelter system. They cannot interact with other animals. So a lot of these dogs develop issues, you know, over time, because it's basically isolation, which is super cruel for an animal that is so social and needs so much from humans and animals. And so I was expecting Murdoch to be this beast, you know, you think dog fighting, oh my God, you imagine these big dogs and it's so scary. And so I had been warned that he was going to be there and I was going to photograph him, and I was excited, but I was also a little terrified.
Sure.
It was also early on. I had just started the project. So I was still learning about pit bulls, and I'm like, I don't know about this. And then they say, okay, now it's Murdoch. We're going to bring him in. And everything in me just tensed up. And they open the door, and the dog, I hear the dog going, like, you know, like just running towards in excitement. And I'm bracing myself like, oh, this is going to be terrible. This is the worst idea I've ever had in my life. I'm going to die. And here comes this little nugget. And he jumps on my lap and he just goes like this, and he wants belly rubs and he kisses me. And I'm like, it's such a cognitive dissonance, you know, in that moment.
Yeah.
It's like that beast coming out of hell. And it's just a cute little doggy that just wants to be loved so much. And so the shoot went really well. He was a great model. He was adorable. The only hard part about the shoot was that he constantly wanted to come say hi and give me kisses and hang out with me, you know, and that was, it blew my mind.
I bet it did.
Little understanding we have of these dogs and how much love they have to offer.
Was there another one from that series that you'd want to talk about, Sophie?
Yeah, I mean, I think maybe Blossom, which is actually on my wall in my apartment, because Blossom was also an early model. 2014 is the first time I photographed her. In the years I've known her, she was adopted and returned 4 times. And mostly because of prejudice against pit bulls. It was never her fault. She's a great doggy, but she kept like having bad luck. One of her adopters moved to Germany and they don't allow importation of pit bulls. So she got back at the shelter. Like, it was a constant cycle of bad luck. So I heard she was back at the shelter and I rushed there. I was on Long Island. I rushed to the shelter to photograph her again. And so it had been 6 years since I had first photographed her, and I decided to crown her again. And you can see when you put the two portraits together, like the years, the disappointment, and how much humans have failed her over the years. The new portrait, she's older, she has, you know, white hair, and the sparkle in her eye was gone. She wanted nothing to do with humans. Like, she's so tired of that cycle. And so I reached out to a friend who agreed to foster her, and we took her out of the shelter immediately, or very soon after the shoot. and she's been with my friend ever since.
Ah.
Sadly, she's terminally ill now, and we don't know how much she has left. So my friend decided to keep her forever, you know, and
that is amazing. What a great story. It choked me up.
Sometimes the perfect home is not the one you hoped or you dreamed of. Sometimes it's just someone that says, you know what, you've been bounced around enough, I'm keeping you.
One of the things you talk about also is the way that we have sort of pushed dogs into this expectation of a very narrow set of behaviors. And when they don't, you know, conform with that, we consider them sort of not our dog. It's this fantasy of what the dog should be. And it leads to, I think, this heartbreaking dichotomy that, you know, you point out of the billions that people spend on pets and the many, many, many animals that are sitting in shelters.
Yeah, I think it comes with the fast culture as well. You know, we, especially in the US, it's a culture of consuming, you know, the world around you, and you have to buy stuff. And I think dogs and pets have fallen into that category a little bit. During the pandemic, it's been revealed to an extent that is concerning. You know, everybody wanted a puppy now, a puppy, I need a puppy now. And the rescue community braced themselves because we're like, what are you going to do when you go back to real life, whatever that looks like? The idea of buying pets, I think, is completely misguided, and we need to really curb that. Most of these puppies come from puppy mills or really horrible situations, and it's an impulse buy for a lot of people, or they get tricked or manipulated into buying a puppy because the store will tell you, oh, I'm going to return that puppy to the farm. They're going to be euthanized because nobody wants him because he has a wonky paw or whatever is going on with that puppy. And people feel like they're rescuing an animal. They said, but if I don't buy that puppy, then he's going to die. I need to save that life.
Yeah.
But the more we buy from these people that are usually, you know, just scamming you really into buying a very unhealthy puppy, the more we continue this process, the more we perpetuate the cycle of abuse. And we have to think about the moms that are stuck in cages on the puppy farm somewhere, and they're just making puppies all year round. And we have to think about the bigger picture.
And then the other thing that really gets me on this topic is that there are so many wonderful dogs in shelters who are not puppies, but they tend to get overlooked.
It's very hard because I understand that people want the puppy experience. I do think, though, that adopting an older, you know, dog or a pet from a shelter is such a beautiful way to go about it. You save a life that is already here and there instead of buying a puppy, for example. You save a life, you help a dog who has fallen on hard times. You know, I think there's a misconception that most of the animals that are in shelters are there because there's something wrong with them. Or they're dangerous, you know. I talked to people at the dog park and they said, oh, I tried to adopt, but they only had vicious pit bulls at the shelter. And I'm like, first, they don't only have pit bulls. But second, how do you know these dogs were vicious? Like, vicious is not even an animal trait. It's a human trait because it implies intentional cruelty, which animals are incapable of. Okay, they can't be cruel. Animals react, animals are scared, animals, you know, go through a lot of emotions. So there's so many dogs at the shelter that are perfect, perfect. And they're sitting in cages because their family moved or fell on hard times, divorced, or their owner died. You know, there's so many reasons why animals end up in shelters. And I think we still have a lot of education to do out there to tell people, like, there's nothing wrong with these animals. They just had bad luck, and now they need someone to step up for them.
Sophie, let's talk a little bit more about the process of your work. What's the most challenging part of photographing dogs?
It's funny because, you know, if you ask me today, I'd be like, it's not challenging at all. It's fun and the dogs cooperate and it's great. But when I'm in the shoot, I'm like, why do I do this to myself? It's so challenging. You know, the dog doesn't want to sit there, or it's scared, or it's like, oh, it wants here, it's come here, it's supposed to stay there. And it is challenging, but it's also what makes it so exciting to me. I really love this. It's sort of a partnership with the dog. You're trying to communicate to them what it is you want. And if it doesn't work, it's because you're not communicating the right way. Dogs are very, very attentive and very attuned to what humans want. That's why that partnership with dogs has worked so well for thousands of years. So on these photo shoots, my job is to communicate with them and them to communicate back to me. And together, we try to find that perfect moment where everything comes together and that photo is born. And when that happens, it's the most exciting part of my job. I love it. And I think the dog loves it too. They like, did I do it? Yeah. And both of us, we sigh, you know, a sigh of relief. And it's so exciting. I love that part of the process.
And Sophie, how much of an impact do you think a photograph can have?
Tons. I mean, I see it with my work. Sometimes I forget because I'm so busy with helping the next dog that I don't take time to sit with it and realize, wow, that photo really made a difference. But I'm constantly reminded with hundreds of messages I've been getting, you know, on a weekly basis of people from all around the world. I think those photos help us several levels. First, a good photo will help connect to adopters. When you want to adopt a dog, and if you've ever visited websites or you know, shelter website, you scroll down and it's like pages of dogs. And if you see a cute photo that pops out, like that's going to draw, it's marketing, really. It's going to make you want to click on that profile. So it helps at that level. I feel like it also helps make shelter dogs look more elevated. And if we go back to the idea that people think shelter dogs are dirty and sick and old and broken, if you have a beautiful portrait with a sparkly eye and a cute smile and the background is clean and the dog looks clean and happy and healthy, that's going to help also, you know, propagate this positive image about shelter animals. And then I have people reach out to me saying, you've inspired me to volunteer, to foster, to adopt. I have people telling me I changed their mind about pit bulls. So I think really visual art and photography are such powerful tools to convey messages, to change minds, because it happens in a split second. It's about this emotional connection that you create with that image. And no amount of words can have the same impact. You know, they say a picture is worth 1,000 words or whatever the saying says. It's true, because especially in the world of social media, where people are bombarded with information all day long, that one split second of, ooh, what was that? Oh, cute dog. And before you know it, you realize, oh, that's a pit bull. But I thought I was afraid of pit bull, but that pit bull is not scary. And like immediately your mind is changed forever.
I am always trying to get the perfect picture of Hudson. Beautiful. Any tips for, you know, us amateurs at home?
Yeah, I mean, I think most people tend to do too much on the shoots. They're like, well, look over here. They squeak, you know, they throw treats. I always do less is more for shoot. I think a whisper. A lot of our dogs have key words like, are you hungry? For Mike, it's, are you hungry? So he's looking at me and they're like, yes, I am. Why? You know, do you want to go for a walk? So you can use those words, those trigger words, and just be ready with your phone or your camera and just, and try that. And you'll see the head tilt, the ears perk up. So I think it's about finding, again, it's the language.
You have a rescue dog yourself. And
yes,
MacLovin, is that right?
MacLovin, yeah.
So tell us a little bit about him.
Yeah, MacLovin. I found him in a shelter in Puerto Rico, actually. I used to do a lot of rescue work in Puerto Rico, and that's where I did a lot of work with stray dogs, and that's where I learned how to rescue dogs, you know. And so I went back in 2016, and I visited an animal control facility there. He was there, and he was going to be euthanized. Because of his looks, they felt like he was not cute enough. I meet a lot of dogs, obviously, with my work, and I've always been tempted to adopt. But with MacLovin, he didn't look at all like the kind of dogs I thought I would ever get. But I saw him, I saw his eyes, and there was something about him. It felt like I saw an old friend. And it was like we were soulmates, really. And in that moment, I knew, like, I just can't leave him. He has to come home with me. I texted my husband a photo and I said, meet your new son. And that's how it started. And yeah, he's a perfect match to us. And he's so sensitive and soulful and special. And I love rescue dogs.
Me too. Because I have to say, you know, I don't know about you, but during the pandemic, during this whole time period, my dog, I mean, Hudson has been, boy, such a sanity saver for me. Very grounded. You found the same thing?
Yeah. I mean, sometimes I look at MacLovin and I feel like he's like, can you guys go back to work? I would love some me time now. So they definitely saved us, but I don't know that they're okay with the arrangement.
Exactly. So Sophie, what's next for you? I imagine it's been hard. You haven't been able to go into shelters during this time period, but what comes next?
I am working on a new project, which is about rebranding dog meat dogs in South Korea. I'm working with Human Society International, And they basically have a campaign there to encourage adoption of dog meat dogs in South Korea. So we're supporting local animal advocates. So similar to what I did with pit bulls, it's about showing dog meat dogs as pets and soulful dogs and not meat. So I've visited meat farms there, you know, and it's been a very intense, incredible experience. And now I'm working on a beautiful series of portraits of dogs who have been rescued from dog meat farms and have been adopted. And so it's a similar approach. It's about changing the perception people have of these dogs.
That's amazing. We save a dog and they kind of save us right back, don't they?
Oh, yes.
Sophie, thank you so much for all this time. And thank you for what you're doing on behalf of animals, because they are family in every way.
Yes. Thank you so much for having me. I love talking about these things and sharing with everyone, you know, what I've learned in this journey. So thank you.
I hope you found that conversation as interesting as I did. That wraps up another chapter of Book It with CA, but we will be back soon. In the meantime, please follow us on Facebook and Instagram. We would love to hear from you, and suggestions are always welcome. Thanks so much for watching. I'm Carol Anne Riddell. See you next time.